Good morning. The departing day has come. Samprati upasthito viraha pattudu. Anything should have a beginning and end.
All well that ends well, so says Shakespeare. One of my friends says, all well that ends. Like that it happens. But the beauty of a Vyasa Valmiki Kalidasa and Gunatya, they will not end. They will always make another newer and newer beginning. They become inseparable part and parcel of our life. This morning when I was talking to Shashi, I was quoting a verse from Kalidasa's Raghuvamsham about a thing, and he immediately responded exactly, perfectly as an answer to my comment by quoting one verse from the same poets, another epic, Kumarasambhava. How it can happen? Because in the voice of poets, in the voice of these great masters, all our voices, all our emotions are recorded. We know nowadays we have something like music bank. So many crores of creative musical pieces have been banked there, booked there. Anyone can draw at any time. Like that, if we can get the connectivity, we can always draw from it. Because the human emotion is so well understood and emanated by those great poets. This is where we can have a commonality with the whole world. Always the fear of getting lost, fear of getting isolated, fear of getting unrecognized, that bothers us. But once we come in contact with these great masters, then we'll be knowing already so many things are familiar to them and they have been revealed there. It means we are no way different from them. Here we have a great solace of agreement. Not only agreement, enjoyment. I have many voices which are in convergence with me. I am no way left for myself. This way of belongingness without any burden. Generally, belongingness will have an element of responsibility, and that's why people never want to enter into any relationships. But the beauty of Vyasa Valmiki and Kalidasa is the belongingness is never made heavy. And the belongingness never expects anything in reciprocation of that. Because of all these features, we naturally develop a sort of joyful indebtedness for that. True responsibility is a joyful indebtedness. And that comes only by enjoying things, only by feeling the oneness with the cosmos. In these poets, we see that. It is also said in the Vedas, all the voices are recorded in the cosmic space. That's why Devim Vacha Majanayanta Devaha Tam Vishwarupa Pashavo Vadanti Sano Mandreshumur Janduhana De Nurva Gasman Upasushtataitu. In these lines, it is also said, Ashtapadi Babhushi Navapada Sahasrakshara Parame Vyoman. Ashtapadi, Navapadi, Babhuvishi, Sahasrakshara, Parame, Vyoman. It is infinitely growing. And that cosmic voice is nothing but our emotional being. No supernaturality need be applied to that. Many times, cosmic means we immediately think something which is meta-worldly. No. Our own emotions, when they are universalized, when they are separated from the selfish end, they become enjoyable, and that is the secret of rasa. All of us know by this time. Because of that, the voice of so many cultures, the voices of so many people are present there. What problem I faced in my life, or what enjoyment I am having, all that is, one way or the other, echoed or reflected. It means not that there is nothing new in the sense. The very concept of novelty or not is too superficial. If I can enjoy a thing,
then it is still new. If we cannot enjoy a thing in spite of its novelty, it is old, it is outdated. The concept of enjoyment is the hallmark of novelty. And that's why Magha, another great poet, though not of the eminence of Kalidasa by any standard, says, Kshane kshane yan navatam upaiti tadeva rupam ramaniyatayaha. Whenever we make a revisit, if it is fresh, then that is the definition of beauty. The nitya navinata, that is very, very important. And here, Vyasa, Valmiki, Kalidasa, they score over many, many other poets. Every country, every nation, every culture will be having such poets. But we are so fortunate to have so many such great poets. By any world standards of the world, these poets are far more important and far more influential when compared to the rest. And that's why it becomes a safe bet. Yesterday, Srimati Anupama was speaking, when I want to invest my time, energy, resources, how to? I have to have a dependable estimation, dependable source. Here we have this idea, this concept, this presentation has stood the test of time, means it is a safe bet. Of course, Vyavahar Prapancha, the world of economy, world of commerce, depends on probability and not on possibility. It's only the world of art that ponders more over the aspect of possibility than probability. Rama had to go to forest on the day of his coronation. It is not a probability. It's a very, very remote probability. But it is one among the possibilities in anyone's life. This is where the scope of art is much more wider and much more bigger and much more deeper than that of the real world. In the real world, often and often, it goes by the concept of probability. But in the art world, possibility naturally includes probability and goes beyond that. Then, emotionally, we are more prepared than the people who are the advocates of probabilities. But unfortunately, the people who are the champions of probability, and that's why they are very much successful in their commercial endeavors, will be ridiculing people like me and my friends for engaging with, entertaining with, immersed in the world of possibility. But they don't understand one thing. We have an emotional robustness, emotional soundness, which is the bedrock of all vyavaharas. Ultimately, the world is not ruled by the intellect. It is ruled by the emotion, because intellect becomes a born slave to emotions. The great poet DVG has so beautifully phrased this in one of his poems. Nasikada matadinda Cleopatralige dasaradar Caesar Antonigal deshakam jasakam ankushavaitu nasaputadareke mankutimma. The profile of Cleopatra's nose that dictated the fate line of the whole Roman Empire for three generations. Pompey, Julius Caesar, and Marcus Antony. If her profile of the nose were to be different, then the European life itself, the Roman Empire itself, would have been something else. Likewise, you look into any such thing, any such eventful thing will be governed by emotions. Ravana, such a personality, such a strong person, emotionally reacted to Sita. If it were to be an intellectual reaction, he wouldn't have bothered. After all, what is the beauty? What's all the great beauty of Sita? Like that he would have thought. Because intellect can compare and contrast things, while emotion loses sight of so many such things. And you just think of Duryodhana. In the case of Duryodhana also, when so much of the empire was with him, he was not satisfied with it. He wanted the small kingdom of Pandavas. After all, what they had, Indraprastha and some surrounding territory. But he wanted it. He was not ready to part of even one village. It means it is the emotion. My prestige should stay with me. I should be myself. I should never be challenged by anyone. My born hatred for Pandavas should win over. In that way, when he thought, what will happen? And so is that. Positively, such things, how they make out, classic example is Parvati. On the other day, Arjun, he was dealing with Kumar Sambhava. There in Parvati's penance, Nakama Vrittir Vachaniya Mikshate, that line appears in the fifth canto. When Shiva appears in the form of a Vatu and wants to test Parvati, you are not acting as per the worldly wisdom. What are the qualities which are needed for a prospectus bridegroom? These are. But from any standard, your view is not that. Then what to do? Then she said, these are all the virtues, yes. No, I can't agree. Well, let it be so. Whatever may be that, I am with him. In one play of Moliere, the hero who is loved by the heroine was naturally hated by the villain. He comes to the heroine and says, you shouldn't love him for these reasons. Then he gives paper and pen. You please add some more negative qualities which you don't know. All are with him in spite of that I love. This is the way of emotion. Means the world of possibility, is it foolish? Not at all. What I'm saying, it's so powerful. When things are powerful, we should be more careful. We should be more watchful. We should know more and more about the people who are powerful. Gantavyam rajakulam drashtavyas tatra nrupati nikata purushaha yadyapi nabhavantyarthaha bhavanti anartha pratikaraha. Just before 2-3 days, me and Shashi were looking at this Subhashita for the class he was preparing. In the Sundar Pandya's Niti Dvishishtika or Arya, we have to go to the high offices of the rulers. There, people in the high positions have to be acquainted. They have to be kept in good books. Though we may not be getting any benefits, harms will be avoided. Any harm that may be created by them will be avoided. So this is where the emotions have to be studied. And no psychiatrist, no psychologist can be of great help here. Because they have, after all, a model which is developed since 50 or 60 years. But Vyasa's model is 5,000 years old. Valmiki's model is 6,000 years old. And based on these epics, we have to model the human nature. One of my friends last year who had accompanied me here, Dr. Shankar Rajaraman, is doing such a study of Natyashastra in the light of such psychological researchers. There, these emotions, they become far more stronger, and the nature of it is much more influential than the recent studies of psychology, for it is an infant subject yet. When I was a visiting professor of Nimans, Bangalore, I was asked to teach Indian philosophy and various systems of Indian philosophy along with the theory of rasa. Even the vice chancellor used to sit in the class and used to honestly accept, well, this is something great, this is something deep, and here we have to explore more. Because modern psychology has studied more about the abnormality of human mind, not about normality. It has studied more about the bad, the perversions of the mind, not about a sane mind. Because who come as patients? Disturbed people. And they will be studying, and no sane mind will be going and subjecting itself to them. And hence, deeper studies have not been done about a happy life. Unhappy family is studied. And unfortunately, unhappy homes are too many and too variegated, we cannot exhaust. We'll be lost in the problem. As Tolstoy says, all happy homes are alike, while every unhappy home is unhappy in its own way. And that's why it will be a never-ending problem. Chakravala samasya, as we call in the logical language of Sanskrit. Because of all these, it's better to go for some standardized models, while the danger of simplification is too probable in the worldly scientific modules of standardization. Because to standardize things, we have to truncate many things, we have to ignore so many things which are falling out of a frame. So the fringe area will be ignored completely. But here it is not. This standardization is product of deeper and deeper contemplation, and it not ignoring the other facets and other fringe effects. Because of all these things, I think great poets are safer bets. Here we can have a comparative understanding also, whether it is east or west or anywhere, we have that. What all we have covered till now, something about the characters in the Mahabharata, mainly focusing on Krishna, and then the complete story of Ramayana with some main characters like Rama, and then Lakshmana, Bharata, parallel way Sita, and the three brothers, Ravana, Vibhishana and Kumbhakarna, Hanuman. These are some of the things which we covered in Ramayana. The content of the epics is very important. And then coming to Kalidasa, how his form has influenced so much, and the subtlety of that, and how he vividly picturizes that. Yesterday, Shishikiran was saying about the ruling of Atithi, son of Kusha, who was the first son of Rama. In the administration of Atithi, because he was a good king, as a reward to him, as a token of gratitude to him, mines produced good mineral and precious stones, good minerals and precious stones. And then the forest produced good elephants, and the fields yielded good harvest. Like that, the whole earth produced something which is most cherished and then offered as a token of gift. It means here he's saying a good ruler would make all these things vitalized and all these things enriched. In a good country which is ruled by a better governance, mining will not be exploitation. It will be for sustenance. In the Manusmriti, it is clearly said, Sarvakareshu Adhikaraha Mahayantra Pravartanam Himsa Oshadhinam Strajivaha Upapataka Itismritaha. Exploitation of underground resources to a worst order is one Upapataka. And then building great dams across the rivers, very big dams across the rivers, huge, gigantic dams, is another calamity. And then chopping of the trees, deforestation is another Upapataka. And then exploiting the women and making them work irrespective of their status, and then getting them worked up as well, it is the Upapataka. This is how he classifies. And here Atithi managed the scene in such a way that mines were well balanced, and so the forest resources. If you want to have good forest products, forests have to be resurrected. Forests have to be respected and protected. As we know, we have a axiom called Vanasimhanyaya. Because of the thick forest, dense jungle, wild elephant, wild animals like lions are protected. Because of the habitation of lions, none would dare enter into the forest, and so the forest remains thick and intact. This way of mutual respect and support, that is what we see in Kalidasa's Atithi Rajaniti, one passing verse. The construction is so copious and neat. This expression is so catchy and impeccable. This is how the form of Kalidasa has percolated into all walks of Indian art. Coming back to Vyasa, how vividly he understands and portrays human emotions. This morning I was recollecting one heart-touching scene when Karna is anointed as Angaraja, his adopted father, Adhiratha, appears. He was already an old man. Yashtigata Pranaha. He was having a stick in his hand to support himself. Yashtimatragata Pranaha. He was so weak, so thin, so humble. And then, tears in the eyes, he comes, Putra Itya Bravit Sartham Vachaha. My son, not even my son, Putra. His character was given only one word dialogue in the whole range of Vyasa's epic. Vyasa's epic crosses 1 lakh verses, and then this character's dialogue is one. Sometimes we have our own grouses. When I was in theater as an active artist in my own humble way, then always the problem, how much of dialogue, how much of stage space, how much of time, how much of lighting will be for a character? Will I be getting recognition? Will I be getting my stakes? Something of that used to be bothered everyone. Here, the character Adhiratha perhaps would never have bothered that. Well, it may be one word dialogue or one line dialogue, I don't bother. How impactful it is. People who have gone to the original with a compassionate heart would never forget that wonderful pen picture. His costume is flowy garment, old man with a stick in the hand, flowing beard as well perhaps, tears in the eyes. That is how the sattva is created. And then Karna rushes to him. He wants to fall at the feet. Immediately, the old man pulls down his uttariya and covers his feet. No, no, no. You have become king. You should not touch my feet. These are the actions. And one word is the dialogue. His tears roll on the head of Karna, which are already drenched with the Abhisheka Jala. And this imagery has influenced Harishena, Kalidasa, Bhasa, and n number of other poets in various languages. This is how Vyasa arrests one intense moment within the span of a word, a verse. Hardly the whole situation takes not more than 2 anushtups. Within that span, he has crystallized it forever. This is the power of Vyasa. And even in Valmiki, such a thing is remarkably presented. To give one example, we have the Trijata. Rama, while going to the forest, will be encountered by an old Brahmin whose leg is impaired, and so he can't walk properly. Again he comes with a yashti, again with a walking stick, and Rama requests him, what all you need? Oh Rama, it is known that you are going to give away all your property and you are already given. I am in need of cows. Can you fetch me a few cows? Then Rama, smiling, says, look at this cattle field. Here are the cattle grazing, all that belongs to me. You throw your walking stick that you have, support stick, crush you have. You throw it. To which extent it falls, within the purview, all the cattle, all the cows, I'll be giving for you. Then this man ties the uttariyam, which was hanging on the shoulder, to the waist, and somehow he straightens his body, takes the stick, throws, as though he is throwing his life itself along with that. It goes and falls on the other banks of the Sarayu River. It means this was not needed in the epic at all. If we are too stringent and if we want to be too economic about the words, about the situation, but Valmiki would find for that. Rama enjoyed humor, and even in intense moments of emotional distress, he would accommodate himself for such things. And how an insignificant man by name Trijata, who would have never been known to anyone but for this, is created. Means Angaraja, Karna, and his father Adhiratha, they are of course essential characters in Mahabharata. they play key roles. For them also Vyasa has, but insignificant and rather unwanted in the probable world, in the material world, Trijata is unwanted. The whole episode of Trijata is unwanted. But to reflect the nature of Rama, Vyasa takes. This way, the great epic poets have so much to say, so much to convey to us. In Kalidasa, we cannot even think of the vividity. One of the fond verses in Shakuntalam, in the sixth act, it only a painter, or at least I think a choreographer, or an animator, or a great gifted dance use like Dr. Padma Subbam can only perform this sancho, not for all. That verse is how Shakuntala, in her bashful nature, was turning her face away from Dushyanta, while Dushyanta wanted to kiss her. This is all the situation. Mohurangoli samvratadharoshtam pratishedhakshara viklavabhiramam mukhamamsa vivarti pakshmalakshyaha kathamapyunnamitam nachumbitam tu. The meter is Aupachandasika. It's a very beautiful sagging and tightening emotions. First, it is loosening, that is the sagging of that. And then the second half of the line is tightening and rewinding. Muhurangulisam vratadharoshtam, muhurangulisam vratadharoshtam, pratishedhakshara viklavabhiramam, mukhamamsa vivarti pakshmalakshya kathamapyunnamitam nachumbitam tu. Like that, the leap in the second half is felt. She is muhuranguli samvratadharushtam. She want to keep him away physically, but emotionally it's impossible. Muhuranguli samvratadharushtam. She wants to cover, not like this. If she had covered like this, it would have been very difficult for Dushyanta to open her lips. It was like this. You would have seen, I think Ramaji may be remembering, in our 60s, 50s films and all, this was a favorite style of our heroes. Oh God, like that. Oh, not. Ille, appadi pandradille, appadi mudiyaradille, something like that. Like that, biting the hand, something like this used to be the posture. Muhuranguli samvrata, trying to push him away. Pushing is more important than protecting. If I push him, he will come by this way. I know it. But pushing, as though I am resisting him, is very important. Muhuranguli samvratadharoshtam, covering the lips. Pratishedhakshara viklavabhiramam. No, no, no. Ma, ma, manada, muncha, muncha, sahasa. Like that Amaruka says, no, no, no. Please, restore my respect, restore my dignity. Like that. Pratishedhakshara viklavabhiramam. The contours of the lips are shaped in such a way while utterance, the dynamic nature of the lips. While we speak, the lips move up and below, up and low, higher and lower, and then they expand and contract depending upon the nature of the vowels. U means it will converge, A means it will diverge, like the O, some such thing. So the lips are constantly varying their shapes. Naveen and others, they know Oshtabheda in Natya Shastra. And that movement of the lips is because of the utterances. Pratishedhakshara viklava, anxiously saying no, the anxiety and the utterance, they are directing the contours of the lips and they are making a dynamic variations in their lips. And that is so beautiful, Abhiramam. The movement of the lip is so beautiful to behold while uttering no, that's all it. But how beautifully it is put, Pratishedhakshara viklava Abhiramam. And then, she is turning the face towards her shoulders. Aunsa vivarti. Aunsa, this shoulder. Vivarti, turning. No, no, no. Like that she is making. And then he is unable to turn. Somehow he makes it. Kathamap yunnamitam. Like that she is moving. He turns, lifts the chin. In the Saundar Lahari, Shankara says, your chin was lifted. It is something like the foundation stone, the keystone, set stone of your face palace. Arjun, you remember that in Saundarlari, after 60 verses or so, after that, Stuhina Vamshad, Bhajshap Mukta Vandidharaha, Tuhina Girina Vatsalataya, Girisheno Dastam, Muhradara Pana Kulataya, Katankara Brumaha, Tavachubuka Maupamya Rahitam. Your chin is so beautiful, with all affection, Himavan would have lifted it to kiss you like a father, as a father. And Shiva would have lifted your chin, and so as to make your face closer to kiss with love. And such a beautiful chin, what to compare with that? So it is the foundation stone, that's what I think. If Parvati's face is the palace of beauty, Saundarya, here is the foundation stone. And foundation stone will be below that center, and something will be engraved, and here generally you'll be having some beauty spot on some such thing here, on such a date, such and such dignitary, they laid the foundation stone, something like that. That would have been it. And Kathamap Yunnamitam, somehow he could lift the face, Na Chumbitam tu, but couldn't, he was unable to kiss. This particular situation is so vividly explained. Do we need in a play? A play is a thing which has to be enacted. It is something like stage direction. In Kalidasa's plays, not only in his, even in most of the Sanskrit plays, how to act and how to present, and all these stage directions come as part and parcel of the poetry of the play. It means, in other plays of the moderners, if you read, you don't feel the enjoyment unless you watch it on the stage. But Sanskrit plays, even by having a reading, cursory reading, you will enjoy it, because all the things meant for enjoyment are again supplied with it. It is something like everything has been already given. You need not take the trouble of imagining separately. So is the richness of Kalidasa. It means these are some beautiful moments in life which may go like this, which may come somewhere. We may not even recognize how they are coming and going, but our poets have eternalized this, immortalized this. It is the way of, often and often I mention, slowing down the pace of life, retarding the pace of life. In the Manusmriti it is said, to have long life, one should breathe long. And that has become the yoga technique, pranayama technique in the modern times. So many people have encashed this concept. There he says, Rishayo dirghasandhyatva dirghamayur vapnihu. Dirghasandhya means, in sandhyavandanam, pranayama is an indispensable act. When they are undergoing that, because of that long breaths, they could restore their life. That is how, because of the long sustaining thing, Hari will be knowing how difficult it is to sustain a long bowing technique. Once the bow is pulled, you have to maintain it. The pressure, speed, angle, all are very important. So is that maintaining Shruti, maintaining Swara. In one swara, standing in one swara, how difficult it is. That is the sadhana, and that is the capability of the singer. Many here, even Arjun as a flute player will be knowing, and even Sri Swapnil will also be knowing, to stay on a swara. Stillness in the world, which is nothing but dynamics. The very name of the world, Jagat. Jangamyate iti Jagat. That is fast moving. And prapancha, pacha vistare, always expansive. By space it is moving, by time it is moving. In both the sense, it is moving world, it is changing world. It is a very transitory world. Such a world, in that we have to arrive at stillness. And the stillness is not of inertness. And stillness is the world and life of vitality and rasa, taste and aswada. That is what Kalidasa means here. In that way, these epic poets, these great poets, would make us transcend space and time, transcend the speed of our mundane world, retard that, and leave us for ourselves. This is how one is looking at our own emotions, other is intensely maintaining one's status, contemplating over that, and developing sustenance. Yesterday I was speaking about Ananda Anubhava. Ananda Anubhava is feel for joy and capacity to feel that joy. That is very, very important. If a poor man is gifted with an elephant, what will do? It is a curse to him. If a person not even having denture is gifted with a pack of my favorites, what all we know, crisp, fried things, condiments, chakli, kodbale, like that, murk and all varieties, what he will do? Is it not an insult to him? So is that Ananda Anubhava is very, very important. For that Ananda Anubhava, Trana is much more important. That sustenance is also provided by the great poets. They not only offer Ananda Anubhava, they also give immense strength to have it forever. And even if we work a bit, we can offer and share that with many other people as well. And our ananda would never diminish in that process. It will rather be multiplied. One great Gujarati poet, whose name was referred to in one of the deliberations, Umashankar Joshi, as he had translated Shakuntalam, he and Kannada poet, great poet Kuvempu, they had to share Jnanapita award. Both were friends. Kuvempu wrote one poem, Prema Ganita, Mathematics of Love. Jnanapita money, it was 1 lakh divided into 50-50. 50,000 went to Kuvempu and 50,000 to Umashankar Joshi. Then he wrote, we shouldn't worry, we shouldn't be disturbed for having got half of the money, because you are my friend and I am yours. And your money, 50,000, is mine and mine is yours. Now we have 1 lakh each. Both of us have 1 lakh, and that 1 lakh of yours is mine and mine is yours, so we have 2 lakh. Likewise, it is something like two parallel mirrors. Between that one lamp, this imagery is mine. It is a physics imagery. How science comes to our help sometimes. This, when the mirrors are in parallel, any object reflected will have infinite virtual images. This is how in Prema Ganita it happens. That is what Kuvempu meant. It means what? This joy of sharing would be endless. This endless experience should we not restore for ourselves? And it is sponsored by the ICPR. The very foundation of Indian philosophy is Ananda, unlike the Western philosophy, which is enquiry. All enquiry should end up in Ananda. If not, what is the use? All that we are doing for Ananda. And so the very purpose of Indian philosophy is this. And ICPR is justly justified for having supported the cause. May it support such causes in the future also in myriad fashions, because of this optimism. That is the assurance India has given to the rest of the world in the pursuit of philosophy. Because many other philosophies of the West, they have been rather depressive in nature, and they are pessimistic, to say the least, and mundane often. But Indian philosophy is not. And the other beauty of it is, all our philosophers, all our masterly writers in Indian philosophy, they have drawn heavily on such poetic imagery. Kalidasa, Vyasa, Valmiki are often and often quoted by people like Shankara, Ramanuja, Madhva and others. For example, Madhvacharya has written a treatise on Mahabharata that is supposed to be his magnum opus according to a traditional scholar in his own lineage. Bannanjaya Govindacharya writes Mahabharata Tatparaniya is the classic of Madhvacharya. And Ramanujacharya declares that Ramayana is Sharanagati Shastra. Means they depend so heavily on Ramayana and Mahabharata. Shankara repeatedly quotes Mahabharata in the Bhashyas. And not to speak of their hymns. And in the lineage of Shankara, many people have written on Ramayana and Mahabharata, and even on Kalidasa. A great scholar like Nagesh Bhatta in the lineage of Shankara, or Appai Dikshita for that matter. Appai Dikshita was so fond of Raghuvamsha. Appai Dikshita is Sarvatantra Swatantra. He was master in all the systems of philosophy, and his favorites were Ramayana and Raghuvamsha. And both these works were gifted by him to his grandson Nilakanta Dikshita at the fagant of his life. Likewise, many such Indian philosophers, peaks of Indian philosophy, pillars of Indian philosophy, they are lured by Vyasa Valmiki and Kalidasa and Gunadhyaya tradition. This is how Indian philosophy draws so much from these epics. At the same time, these epic writers, they were all great philosophers. Who is a greater philosopher than Vyasa? Who is a greater philosopher than Valmiki? In Kalidasa, we find so much of Indian philosophy. Arjun had already mentioned the Bhagavad Gita as reflected in Kalidasa's three works. He may be speaking about that also. In that sense, so much is inseparable in Indian context. And that's why it is better not to make compartments. This is poetry and this is not philosophy and this much is our purpose, like that. It is a narrow and unpardonable approach. And that's why the true spirit of philosophy lies in life and experience, and what else but Kavya doing that. With these few words, I conclude as the summary, and I would be eager to know your feedback. I also know that you would have had a lot of difficulty in accepting the approach which we few friends had adopted in devising this workshop and presenting it. I also know it's not flawless. It's not complete. Here and there, we could touch over several themes, several topics, and we couldn't do any sort of great justice to these master poets. To say that we have exhausted, or at least we have given complete bird's eye view of these masters, is audacity of the worst order, to say the least. And that's why it is only the coffee taster's job that has been given to you. And if you get addicted to it, what else is a greater profit to a coffee businessman like me? Thank you. I want your feedback. Whatever may be, sweet or sour, it will not matter, because both are needed to prepare panakam, shadava as we call in the context of Bharata. We need lime, we need sugar, we need water, we need kesar, we need cardamom, we need so many things, and then only it is prepared. And Natyashastra is always for such amalgamation and synthesis, and all your opinion will end up in a tasty juice, that is rasa. Thank you.